Hi guys, welcome back to my channel, and if you're new, welcome to my channel. My name is Stephanie Yates Anya Buile, Steph Anya for short. I'm a licensed associate marriage and family therapist, and this channel is for fellow therapists, those thinking of becoming therapists, and those who are just simply looking to create their best lives. The video today is really for all three. Today we'll be talking about defense mechanisms, and it'll be helpful for therapists to learn how to best identify defense mechanisms when they're happening in session. For those of you at home who are just looking to create your best lives, you want to really do a self-assessment here and see which of these defense mechanisms applies the most to you. So if you're interested in seeing which defense mechanism applies the most to you, stay tuned. What's on your mind? Defense mechanisms can be useful, but they also can get in the way of our happiness. Let's first talk a little bit about what defense mechanisms are. In psychotherapy, a defense mechanism refers to an unconscious mental process to really block any negative emotions or cognitions. So that could be anxiety, that could be guilt, that could be depression. And it can be very, very successful and useful for a time in your life, but you want to make sure that you're not taking these defense mechanisms and applying them in situations where they really don't make sense. Because in those circumstances, it really turns into self-sabotage when you're using defense mechanisms when there's really no need for you to be on the defense. And as a relationship therapist, I'll talk about also how I see them mostly impacting my clients' relationships. We'll be talking about how they can be adaptive and functional in your life, as well as how they can become maladaptive, detrimental, and sabotaging. So let's jump in into the top 7 defense mechanisms that I experience in session and in my own personal life. Displacement. This is an extremely common defense mechanism where people might be upset or hurt at one situation or person and they displace it to another place or person. The functional way that that can be used is in a setting where it's really not safe for you to place those negative emotions in that setting. Here's a great example of displacement. I'll have clients who, let's say that they work a very stressful job and they have very strained relationships with their boss or their coworkers. But in that context, because they don't want to lose their job, they never vocalize their frustration. They smile, they keep it going, they get their work done. But then they get home. Let's say they have a roommate, and maybe their relationship with their roommate has actually always been very good. But on those days where they've had a tough day at work, they're nitpicking about everything that they see. They come home, there's a dish in the sink, they fly off the handle. It looks like somebody might have gotten a sip of their milk. They can't believe that somebody would have the audacity to do that. And to the roommate, it feels totally unprecedented. It's like, these are things I did before, why is it such a big issue now? But what they don't understand is that their roommate is displacing the anger they have in their workplace in this more comfortable setting at home. So sometimes you're on the receiving end of these negative emotions, which really should not be targeted at you, but you might be the most comfortable person in that person's life for them to actually take their mask off and be their authentic self. That does not excuse it, but I have seen a lot of times in sessions where we come to this realization and that person almost feels like, okay, I get it. You feel the most comfortable with me. Now, I'm still not okay with it, but that makes me able to handle this a lot better because at least I know that I'm not just always making you mad. It's really that I make you the most comfortable. The next defense mechanism is disassociation. This is one that is not terribly maladaptive. It actually has a lot of functional purposes, but there are ways that it can get in the way of your relationships. So disassociation, on a basic level, we're talking about things like sitting in class and daydreaming, or maybe you get really angry and you meditate and focus on being on a beach. Whatever you have to do to kind of remove yourself from the present situation so that your mind and your emotions can handle what's happening around you. But it can be maladaptive when you are disassociating at times where it's very important that you engage. So for example, I'll have a couple in session and the tension might be escalating. They might be getting really to the root of something that is impacting their entire relationship. And for some reason, you'll look at one of the partners and they're completely checked out. They might lay their head down, they might get on their phone, they might start looking off, gazing off, and the partner interprets that as you're not paying me attention. But what I'm looking at with that partner is that they are so emotionally or mentally drained or overcharged in this moment that they're literally trying to escape it as much as they can. And so in those moments where it's very important for you to hear and participate in a moment, when you're disassociating, that can actually really get in your way of resolving issues. Here's a very common defense mechanism that is amongst some of the most detrimental to healthy relationships, and that is projection. The adaptive version of projection is when you know you're battling certain things and you give people the benefit of the doubt because you know that they could be feeling the same way that you feel, or they could be doing the same thing that you're doing at night, maybe crying themselves to sleep, maybe they have terrifying nightmares. Because you know you feel a certain way and you're projecting that onto them, it might actually give you more insight into how people are feeling. But the maladaptive way is when you try to take negative things that you've done and assume that other people in your life are doing the same things and hold it against them. I often see, especially in couples, where you have one partner who has done something that really has most of the time betrayed the trust and the foundation of the relationship. And what they're trying to do is make things even. So if you have a partner, for example, who has been unfaithful in your relationship, a lot of times you'll see that person putting in a lot of energy to make sure that the other partner feels like they are not a better partner than them. They'll accuse them of being out too late. They'll accuse them of lying. They'll accuse them of having secrets, even though there's really no evidence to support that their partner is doing that. But they want to make sure that all of the negative energy and frustration isn't geared towards them. So they project it onto their partner so they feel like they are even. This is where I often will hear somebody say, neither one of us have been perfect in this relationship. Sure, maybe neither one of you has been perfect, but maybe one of you has been more faithful. Simply projecting your own guilt, disappointment, anger, and frustration onto your partner does not alleviate your actions, and it does not justify your actions. Even if your partner has done something, let them take on their own guilt and their own plan for fixing that. But the healthiest thing you can do when you've messed up in a relationship is to apologize and come up with a plan to fix your actions. And also realize that you are at the mercy of your partner. If you have been unfaithful in a relationship and your partner needs to now see your location, they need you to let them know when you are coming in and coming out. If you want to be in that relationship, these are the new rules of the relationship based on your actions. So you can't project your own feelings of anxiety and guilt onto your partner because you don't want to sit with those feelings. You have to accept and acknowledge what you have done and work your best to fix it and rebuild the trust in that relationship. Splitting. This is one that's not talked about very often, but this defense mechanism is something I see all the time. This is something that comes up a lot with my individual clients, partly because they're not in a relationship or don't have close relationships for them to work on. And part of the reason why that's the case is because they push people away. These clients split in terms of they see everything as either good or bad, or honestly, it looks more like perfect or horrible. And so when my clients are splitting, I'm talking about it could be a work situation. They could get a job, say it's their dream job, love this job, and then one thing happens and all of a sudden their job is toxic, they hate it, they quit the job, and now they're out of work. Or it could be a new friend they meet. 23 out of 24 hours a day, they're talking to this person. This person is perfect. They finally found a great person to be involved with. And then the person does something that doesn't sit well with them or activates one of their existing insecurities, and they will completely cut the person off. Block them on social media, block them from their phone. And these are not healthy ways to approach a relationship. Splitting is really, I think, one of the most detrimental defense mechanisms when it comes to healthy relationships, because people aren't all good or all bad, and you have to have an understanding of a gray area in order to work with people and have the conversations needed to make sure that your relationships can survive hard times and moments that activate your insecurities, because that is bound to happen. Now let's talk about another very common defense mechanism, repression. The concept of defense mechanisms was introduced by Sigmund Freud and his daughter Anna Freud. So it's no surprise that repression, one of the staples of Freud's theories, is one of the most popular defense mechanisms that we experience today. Repression is so much bigger than how we envision it. A lot of times we think, oh, you just have these feelings and you're repressing them. We think of it almost like denial. But repression is actually a huge part of our society and actually a part of why it works. Here are the positives of repression. Repression is the defense mechanism that underlies things like manners. Because we have been taught what is polite, we repress our natural instincts, maybe for fight and flight, protection, and we will do what society is asking us to do. So that is the adaptive form of repression, is that we repress sometimes our most primitive instincts to blend in with society, which can work well in our favor. The maladaptive aspect of repression is that it prevents us from talking about important fundamental things. When we are in a position where we are trying to just blend in so perfectly to society that we actually ignore our own needs and our own truths, that's where we can really see repression taking a serious toll on our emotional and mental well-being. So one of the most primitive defense mechanisms that we're all familiar with is denial. Denial is that everything's fine mentality when it couldn't be further from the truth. And it can be adaptive in situations where we have a lot of information to process. With denial, we can push that information away so that it doesn't overwhelm us emotionally and mentally and take it in bit by bit until we have fully accepted whatever truth it is that we've been avoiding. But here's where denial can be very maladaptive. If you are in the position where you will really never accept the full truth, it can actually take a lot more energy to continue pushing that evidence away than to just deal with the truth as it is. If you and your partner have been going in circles for many years, trying to figure out what's wrong, trying to make it work, it could take you a lot of energy to keep pretending as if there isn't an issue instead of just acknowledging, hey, we've got this big elephant in the room. Let's seek some professional help and see what we can do to solve this problem. So denial is one of the most common defense mechanisms that we all have experienced and probably to some degree have done ourselves. The thing about denial is it's not a conscious process. So a lot of times it's going to take our loved ones in our lives to make us know that this is happening. So if you are that friend who is seeing your close friend be in absolute denial about a situation, whether it be something related to work, something related to their family, their relationship, gently bring evidence to the forefront. See how they respond. They might chew you out at first, but typically when someone's willing to confront a person in denial with the truth in a gentle way, over time, they start recognizing that evidence on their own and they can deal with it, as we said earlier, bit by bit until they can make a decision about that truth. What is thought to be the healthiest defense mechanism? Something that many don't discuss, and that is sublimation. That is channeling all of that negative angst, anxiety, guilt, frustration, and channeling it into something productive. This is where we see a lot of times people who are really high achievers, and they're often doing it because they have been told by so many people that they would never amount to anything. Or maybe the only way they've received love is through accomplishments and achievements. And so they channel all of those negative emotions into being really high achieving. And this is not one that you necessarily need to fix, but you definitely do want to address those negative feelings in some way or another. Whether that be journaling, having open, vulnerable conversations, being in therapy, because they will eat you up and come to haunt you. You can achieve all you want in this world and still go to bed at night feeling anxious and afraid and guilty because you're not dealing with these emotions. So you can continue high achieving, but make sure that you're also honoring and respecting those negative emotions that you have. I hope this helps. I ask that you subscribe to my channel and like this video and comment down below which defense mechanism you have the most experience with, whether that be firsthand or secondhand. Again, my name is Stephanie Yates Anyabwile, Steph Anya for short. I appreciate you for watching until the end of the video. That actually really helps me. Thank you.